Welcome along to episode 769 of the Milk Bar. Jason Forrest here with you as ever. And coming up on the show this week, Jason Merrells let us know all about his part as Juror 8 in 12 Angry Men. We'll be hearing from Lily Rose Shepherd about the Visit England campaign and her work as a paddle sports guide at the Birmingham Roundhouse. Sophie Nichols joins us to talk about M2K music teaching. We'll be finding out about Talking Futures with two former Blue Peter presenters, and Taylor Simner lets us know about his latest work as a child actor and model. That's all on the way on the show this week.
Welcome to the Milk Bar. 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 Welcome to the Milk Bar.
From the 7th to the 11th of May, the Grand Theatre plays host to 12 Angry Men, a courtroom drama. And one of the stars is Jason Merrells, who joins me now. Hello, sir.
Hello.
How's it going?
All right. Hectic drive to get here, but I'm all right.
This is the way it goes, isn't it? I mean, an actor's life is not an easy one. You're very often out on the road, away from home, and telling tales to people across the UK.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. And I had to go back. I'm in Guildford this week. I live in Cambridge. And I just had to go back because I had an appointment in Cambridge I couldn't miss. So it was just a bit of a hectic couple of drives last night and today.
So that's not good. But it does mean at least you're going to be quite angry in time for the play to be on stage. More channeling the sort of day you've had, which works.
Maybe. Yeah, I'm the least angry probably. But I'll try and get angrier. Yeah.
So when it comes to the show, do you have 12 characters who have no names? They have a number on the script, but that's it. And I think that sort of thing makes it an intriguing sort of plot device. Even though this has been around for more than half a century, it's still amazing. Yeah. And people flock to see it.
They do. Yeah. And it's lots of reasons, really. And it's not just because of a certain generation like mine and above, and maybe one below, remembering the film. It's not just that. The film is an excellent film and one of Sidney Lumet's finest and one of Henry Fonda's greatest. But before that, it was a play, and it's a beautifully written play, and it's almost a perfect kind of play, you know, because if you think the essence of drama is conflict and theatre is a spoken medium, then an argument, a conflicting argument, is the kind of ideal setting for a play. And you have, as you say, 12 very distinct New Yorkers set in New York in 1957, America on the cusp of great change and upheaval. And it centers on a Puerto Rican kid who's accused of murdering his father. And it seems pretty cut and dried, except that one of the jurors who I play, juror number 8, has doubts, has questions, really. He's not sure whether he's innocent, but he's not sure that he's guilty. And so from that beginning, that first seed of doubt, it's about how that argument changes in the room and how people are exposed by their prejudices and their beliefs. And it's a fascinating human study, really. It's very funny.
It's got lots of elements to it, hasn't it? And I think it is, it's about those human interactions that when I've seen it in the past, have always been played so well. And we've got an amazing lineup of acting talent here again. And we always get great names in this, present company included. And it is really good to see people who we know from film and TV coming to a production and a theatre production like this, when you may not necessarily expect to see them in a drama of this type.
It's very easy to get pigeonholed in this business, and there are a lot of class-ridden glass ceilings, which are, you know, a part of our culture, I suppose, and our country. We are quite a class-ridden country, but that's also the same in the entertainment industry, and you tend to get put in a box, and oh, he does that kind of thing, or he does this kind of thing. And often theatre is a chance for an actor that can't get a break to do that in a movie or in a TV show or in a series, can do that in the theatre, you know. And I think that's why actors come back to it a lot of the time, because we probably wouldn't get the chance to make the movie of it, you know. So much as we'd love to, it's not, you know, it's probably not that possible. So yeah, it's attractive for all sorts of reasons. But this company, I'm really proud of. I did it before in 2015, and I loved it then, and it was a fantastic company then. But there's something about the mix of this group of actors that I think is more special and stronger. And in particular, with a couple of them, there's a couple of additions that have really changed the way some of the lines land, which I think is great. Great to see.
And when you know, tour with someone like this, it is an emotional roller coaster every night when you're on stage. And this is the joys of acting. You go through it, you live it. And that's why we will believe what we're seeing on stage. But does that sort of thing take a toll, particularly when it's a tour and you've got to dash back home to do things? I mean, do you feel like you are part of that jury when you're not on stage?
I wouldn't say it does in particular. I think about it. I'm not someone that lives and breathes a character outside of work, but there are sometimes shadows and sort of nuances that creep into your daily life, certainly. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that's the gig. The gig is, as an actor in theatre, to tell the story fresh every time. And if you can find a way of doing that and be fresh about it in your approach, then it's a sort of a joy to do. It's like going out there to play. But I mean, if you begin to be bored by it, you will bore the audience. So there's no shortcut to it. You have to live it, and you have to play the story every night. Because if you don't, and if you just try and sit back, you won't. You'll bore yourself and you'll bore everyone else. So the challenge is to keep it fresh and to keep it real, to keep listening to everyone, to make sure that every reaction and action are rooted in reality, really.
And the role of a jury itself is an interesting one in real life. I know people who've both loved being on a jury and absolutely hated it. And, you know, say when they're coming to see a show, it's almost like they're experiencing it through your eyes and actions in a yeah. way in which, you know, it could lead to them to a real life scenario. We could pretty much all be called up for jury service.
Indeed, yeah. I it's never happened to me, funnily enough, but I'd be fascinated to do it. Everyone I know that's done it, it's been very awkward, and it's come at the wrong moment or in the middle of something, and so everyone complains about it. But I'm a big believer in democracy. Mm-hmm. I'm a big believer in being responsible for democracy. So, you know, your vote counts. One of the things that I think Juror 8 believes, this is my personal view, is that in a democracy, what the state does in your name, you know, you basically are doing. So if you put this kid, this 16-year-old Puerto Rican boy, into the electric chair and put a sponge on his head and do what until very recently was quite grimly done to many people in America, then I think you are responsible. That's you, because you, in a democracy, are responsible for what your state does, and it's your job to vote them out if you don't agree. Now, I think he's very strongly an abolitionist of the death penalty. Mm-hmm. This is 1957. He's quite a liberal, I would imagine. This is how I imagine him, quite a progressive architect. You know, the civil rights movement is sweeping across America. There's the 60s is just beginning. And I think he's someone that believes, outside of reasonable doubt, I think perhaps he believes this is something we shouldn't be doing to our fellow man in the name of the state. Quite apart from the fact that there is enough reasonable doubt to not convict. So yeah, it's very, very interesting. We don't, thank God, have that in this country, but yeah, it would still be a fascinating thing to see what it was actually like when the stakes are very high to be in a jury room.
Yeah, if you make a mistake, it is somebody's existence which is called into doubt. So yeah. An amazing play. And I say, I'm so looking forward to seeing what will be a tremendous cast. With Juror 8 in your hands, I know they are safe ones to lead the play through. 12 Angry Men, Wolverhampton's Grand Theatre from the 7th through to the 11th of May. Grandtheatre.co.uk to get your tickets or call the box office on 01902 429212. But Jason Merrells, thank you for joining us. Have an amazing time. Break a leg, and we look forward to 12 Angry Men making its way through the Midlands.
Come and see it. It's very funny too.
Now, when it comes to connecting with the younger members of our family, understanding the world of TikTok can be a little bit confusing. However, you could earn your badge at this. To tell us more, I'm joined now by former Blue Peter presenters Connie Hook and Simon Thomas and Michelle Ray from Talking Futures. Hello to you all.
Hello.
How are you?
Hi, Jason.
First of all, who should we start with? Connie, tell us a bit about your problems connecting with the kids.
Oh, where do I start? My problems connected with the kids. Kids is such a huge topic. So my youngest is 10. He's just gone into double digits. And when it comes to what he wants to do when he grows up, I mean, your guess is as good as mine. He takes after me, I'd say. And I flip-flopped all over the shop. I was going to be an architect at one point, a lawyer, then an engineer. Then when I was younger, an astronaut. I went through every career option you can think of. My elder son has just started secondary school, and he takes after his dad. He's into computing and coding. It's a computing specialism school. He just started in September, and I found out when I went to the open days, they do T levels, which I knew nothing about, but sound like they might be quite apt for him. And I know a lot more since doing this Talking Futures campaign, Earn Your Badge. But yeah, it can be a minefield for parents. And when it comes to the troubles that I have with my children, monosyllabic is a word that comes to mind. I'll often say, how was school today? It's like, fine, good.
No real response. And Simon, when it comes to it as well, I mean, the same sort of thing in your family?
Yeah, well, I've hit the teenage years with my boy Ethan. He's now 14. So it's up and down. It's a roller coaster with teenagers. Sometimes he's very chatty, other days he's not, but that's just the nature of teenage years. I remember being very monosyllabic with my dad, which was massively frustrating for him. He'd pick me up from school off the train, and I didn't have much to say about my day at school. So listen, it goes with the territory. But just because they are teenagers doesn't mean you don't have those conversations. You've got to persevere as a parent and push in, even when the answers are one words.
Yeah, it's almost like you've got to translate those one words into actual real human speak rather than teenage talk.
Yeah.
But when it comes to talking with the teens, it's important that we get that message right, isn't it, Michelle?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it doesn't have to be these big high stakes conversations when it comes to talking about careers either. It feels like you can only have them when it's coming to exam times or option times and all that sort of stuff. And what Talking Futures is all about is just a little bit more little and often. So how do we integrate and weave these conversations into everyday conversations in the house rather than waiting to high stakes times?
Yeah, so make sure you're having a good conversation early. Work out what they want to do before it gets to choosing their options at GCSE. And if they've got some sort of guide, get them involved in clubs or fun or making things. And talking of making things, I think I know two people who've been getting up to some stuff, basically having a bit of fun doing the likes of making Tracy Island. What's going on here then?
Chase, we've been rolling back the years, basically. they wanted the guys at Talking Futures to make three films, which are short, but kind of recreated the spirit of Blue Peter. So it does look a lot like Blue Peter. It's a slightly smaller studio than the ones at TV Centre, but recreating the magic. We hadn't worked together. We've kept in touch. We see each other regularly. We see Matt and Liz, who we worked together with for so long, often. But we hadn't worked together, myself and Con, for the best part of two decades. I left in 2005. So it was magical. It was so bizarre because I thought, I spend my life now being a sports broadcaster. And for this one day, I've got to kind of flip back into being a kids presenter at the age of 50. And I was traveling in the car thinking, how do I do this? But it was a lot of fun. And we just clicked straight back into it. And, you know, do you know what? Why I think this is going to be really effective? Two things. One is the generation this is aimed at is more about equipping parents, because a lot of kids would look at me and kind of go, who? because they never saw us on Blue Peter.
They have the telly.
The worry is, the kids who watched us are now parents. That's how old I am. But for those guys, you know, obviously they'll have the connection with the program. But one of the great strengths of Blue Peter and what would basically land you the job was, could you communicate whilst doing something? That was the quintessential part of the audition. Jumping on a trampoline sounded nuts to anyone outside Blue Peter and interviewing someone at the same time. But they wanted to see, can this guy, can this girl bounce on a trampoline and hold down an interview? And if they can, they've got a good chance of getting the job. So we do stuff like Konnie makes Tracy Island while I'm chatting to the camera. I do a badge challenge where I have to pin as many badges on Konnie as possible in 1 minute. We make banana bread together. All the things you'd have seen on Blue Peter down the years. And we're talking while we're doing something and saying to parents, actually, this is a really simple way of doing something that feels quite big, which is having those conversations about your children's future education, their future in terms of careers. When you do something with them, it becomes less big. It's not a kind of big formal sit down. It's just like, look, you know, my best conversations, for example, with my boy Ethan, are nearly always when we're walking or we're driving in the car and taking him somewhere, because we're not looking at each other in the eyes. We're just having a chat, and I go, you know, because at the moment he wants to be a journalist. Have you thought any more about that school magazine idea I had? Oh, yeah, no, I haven't. Listen, it doesn't always work, because some days they will just go, but other days they'll want to talk.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, Konnie, when it comes to the magic of a make, who's the most skilled with the sticky back plastic, you or Simon?
I think I probably enjoy doing the makes more than Simon, but then he's better at all the sporty stuff. You know,
really depended. It depended on what the make was. I do remember one in particular. So you would often, the makes were on a Monday show. So when you got the script through on a Friday night for the Monday show, you'd feverishly look to see who was doing the make. And there'd be some makes I'd go, this will be a lot of fun, like the cooking ones, because they'd tend to go wrong or get a bit messy. But there was one, it was Simon Make, and it was making a doll's gym. And I by this point, was 31 years of age. And I was living with a couple of my best mates in our bachelor days. And Jason, as they left for work, my mate Graham's off to be a Metropolitan Police officer for the day. My other mate Kristen's off to be a secondary school teacher. And they said, what's on the show today? And I said, lads, I'm making a doll's gym. you couldn't get a bigger contrast in terms of career directions.
It is one of those things. But I mean, with the fact we need communication, Konnie, again, I suppose being a Blue Peter presenter prepared you for parenthood in ways you would never expect it.
I mean, yes, because being a Blue Peter presenter, as Simon will concur, you're just doing something different all the time, and that feels a bit like parenthood, you know. And the kids just go through phases. Like Simon has a 18 month old at the moment, so he's in Nappyville at one end of the spectrum, and then at the other end Ethan is a teenager. And that's the thing, everything is a phase, it's always sort of changing up, and there's loads of obstacles thrown in your way at all times. So it feels very similar to being a computer presenter.
That's such a good question. I'm picking up what Konnie said there, because one of the strengths of the show, but also a challenge as a presenter, was the multiple gear changes. 1 minute you could be doing quite a serious item like The Appeal, the next minute you're doing something entirely bonkers where myself and Matt are dancing in lederhosen outfits. And that's parenting in a nutshell. 1 minute you're larking around, just having a laugh. The next minute, oh, we've got to have a serious question about why Ethan's not finished his homework. So it's those gear changes that we had in Blue Peter that actually, even though we didn't know it at the time, have been great for parenting.
Okay, Michelle, we know how Blue Peter presenters do it, how they can handle parenting, how they're amazing. How do these guys help other people also talk to the kids in the way which is going to help them get their careers right?
Well, what Konnie and Simon have done is create a series of videos. They're all on our website. Simon described, it's just a great way of showing how you can get stuck in, how you can do stuff at home and have these conversations. You go on talkingfutures.org.uk. It's got these guys' videos, but it's also got loads of other resources and tips, advice from behavioral psychologists. There's a chat bot there. Basically, anything a parent could need to help them start having those conversations.
Does it explain to them how to use TikTok as well? That's not there.
It's way beyond anything I'd be capable of putting on the site.
It is a social media free zone. There are very few of those zones in life anymore, but thankfully this one is.
Well, this one's all about talking futures, sticker.org.uk on the end, and you can get help getting the kids in the right direction, whether it be T-levels, A-levels, what they're going to do at GCSE, however it is, you need to communicate that to them so they understand the real scary outside world where you have to pay for things yourself. Then this is the way to do it. Well, for now, Blue Peter presenters, Konnie Hook and Simon Thomas, and also Anne from the wonderful team at Talking Futures, Michelle Ray, thank you for joining us.
Pleasure,
thank
mate.
You Thanks so much. Cheers.
Now, Sophie Nichols is an incredibly talented performer, playing at weddings and all sorts of events, and she is sharing her skill as part of the M2K Music School. And she's come along there to tell us all about what's going on. How are you doing?
Oh, yeah, I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm okay, thank you. Now, good to see you again. I mean, it's been a while since we last had a catch-up, and yeah. You do like to keep yourself busy, don't you?
Just a little bit, yeah. I've been very busy, yes, lately. Recently got promoted to a manager at M2K Music School. For those who don't know too much about it, it's basically a privately owned music academy where we offer musical instrument tuition to children and adults, so all ages. We teach piano, drums, guitar, singing, you name it, we teach it. Yeah, so it's a great little place we've got, and very proud, yes, to be a promoted to manager by my stepdad, Steve. So it's a family business. So it's been very good, and we're keeping very busy as well.
Well, yeah, and it's about the music. Well, that's the important part. And it's so good for kids to learn music. Not only is it a talent that they will enjoy, but a skill that really is a great talking point, even if they're only playing for themselves.
Yeah, definitely. There's so many benefits, you know, to learning a musical instrument, or, you know, learning to sing. It helps so much, you know, refine motor skills, get the fingers going. It enhances, you know, things like maths, you know, reading skills as well. And it's just great for social skills too. Helps bring kids' confidence up. And as I say, we teach adults as well. So it builds their confidence too, to get out there and give it a go.
So how many teachers have you got involved now?
We've got 10 staff, yeah.
That's impressive.
Yeah, I know. It's hard to keep count sometimes. We've got a great team. Obviously, every teacher teaches different instruments, different days, different times. We do weekends. Mainly a Saturday. Nobody likes to really get up on a Sunday. in the week we do, it's mainly after school times because we get a lot of children. So normally it's from like 3 o'clock till 8 in the evening. It's very busy. The rooms are busier in the week. It's all good.
And with the music you perform out and about with the likes of Chris Sophie, your duo with your husband Chris, and all the other work that you do, it just shows how useful and important these talents are. No event works well without music. Music is the way in which our lives come together, and it's really weird because we're the only creature on this planet who could actually really do that, apart from maybe the odd singing birds. But as far as the likes of the tunes that we hear and the way they're performed, you know, it is something special.
It really is. Yeah, I mean, I love the fact that I've got the variety of teaching and, like as you say, going out and performing. It's a feeling that I can't really describe. It's just, you get so much from it, especially performing, you know, this when you've got a great crowd going, and then just the benefit from teaching as well. You're helping that individual blossom into a musician, and then that's something that they could, you know, I can hopefully inspire them to do, you know, go out and get the skills, go to open mics, go out, perform themselves. We do concerts as well, twice a year here at M2K, where we just try and get all the students together, all the staff, and we we'll hire a place and we'll put on a show, and it just, you know, it just helps inspire them and give them confidence to perform, as well as, you know, play and practice at home.
Which works well. Have you roped Chris in on the teaching side too?
Not Chris on the teaching side. He hasn't got the patience, unfortunately. Not at the moment, anyway. But I think maybe it's something possibly he'd like to do in the future. But he very much just likes to stay and perform with myself and individually as a solo instrumentalist. But he is definitely on board. He helps a lot with the IT side. He's very supportive and he helps, you know, with any shows we do and things like that.
Yeah, because having arrangements and things like that, I mean, it is nice to have your own version of a song to play.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, when we do the songs together, they're great. We've recently done a new promo video and that's gone well. And yeah, getting out there and individually as well. We've just released our solo stuff too, so it's inspiring to show students, staff, other staff go out and perform as well as teach. So it's great. It's really inspiring overall.
Well, I say it's impressive work that you're doing. Give us all the details of where we find you.
Yep. So for the lessons, you need to go to m2kmusicschool.co.uk. All the information is on there. We're on social media. You can call us, Wolverhampton number 01902 563 504. But to be fair, it's better if you get in touch via social media or email because we can respond quicker that way. And yeah, we've got, also I can tell you as well, we have got a summer concert coming up this year, which is held at Technical College. And that's on Sunday, the 14th of July this year. We're not sure on a time just yet, but it's going to be roughly around 4 or 5 o'clock. But yeah, all the children, or possibly some adults as well, performing as well. And we're also celebrating our 30th anniversary this year. That's how long we've been operating as a private music academy. So that's exciting. That's on the 1st of August as well.
That's going to be worth doing. So check all the socials and online for details on the concert. Get involved. Give us a quick plug for Chris Sophie as well.
We've got a website, which is Chris Sophie, chrissophiemusicduo.co.uk. And again, if you just search Chris Sophie Music Duo on social media, find us on there. And yeah, check out all our performances too.
Yeah, but as I say, it's not just kids who can learn here, it's adults too, isn't it?
Adults as well. We get all ages, yeah, anything from 5 to an 80-year-old. So it's, yeah, it's great. Great variety.
I must have words. I'd love to be able to play piano, but I learned the violin as a kid, and I have to admit that skill has since left me, unfortunately. But maybe for the best, based on the way I was playing in my later teen years. But there we go. But let's get people learning, enjoying, and performing music in a wonderful way. It's going to be worth checking out the full details. M2K Music is what you're looking for. Sophie Nichols, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. See you soon.
England's Tourism Week is upon us, and it's a chance to explore things not only close to home but further afield. One thing which isn't too far away is the Birmingham Roundhouse Paddle Sport. One of their guides, Lily Rose Shepherd, joins me now to tell me exactly what that is. Hello.
Hi.
How's it going?
Yeah, well, good, thanks. How are you?
I'm okay, thank you. Now, Birmingham Roundhouse, now whereabouts are we experiencing this in Brum itself?
So we're just off Sheepcote Street, so just a little way up from the NIA. or Utilita Arena now.
it's the NIA, that's what we know it
yeah,
as.
It will always be that to me.
Yeah, it's better because you know where you're going to if you say that. Yeah. But obviously a central location, and it just shows off the sort of tourism opportunities that there are. I mean, we've got the same in Wolverhampton and beyond, but this is one in particular which is close to your heart.
It is. I have a very real love for this place.
So tell us a bit about how you got involved, because there's an interesting tale here.
Yeah, so I actually came across it thanks to a Facebook post, but going back before that, I was diagnosed with fibromyalgia in 2021, fell into, you know, quite a dark place, felt very much like my life as I knew it was over, that I wasn't going to be able to be that active anymore. You know, it's in your 20s, no one really wants to hear. And I decided after about a year of being incredibly down about it that I needed to make some changes. And I sat in a pub, as you do, writing out a list of things that I wanted to do with my life. And at the top of that list came up as paddle sport instructor. And the next day I see a post from the Roundhouse saying they were looking for guides, volunteer guides, to become paddle sports instructors and lead tours on the Birmingham canals. I leapt at that as soon as I saw that. I was like, yes, sign me up. And I sent off my application, went through the training, and joined as a volunteer guide, which just felt like it gave me a whole new sense of purpose. And I very much fell in love with the team here and the building itself and everything that the Roundhouse was doing. And then a paid opportunity came up, and again, leapt at that as soon as I could. And now they can't get rid of me.
I mean, you've travelled about a bit. I mean, you started off your life in Bournemouth, then grew up in Sutton Coldfield. So you've certainly got Midlands roots at this point. Yeah. Then head off to London, and now you're back in the region in Lichfield and working in Brum. So yeah, tourism is something which seems to be in your blood just from where you live, let alone actually going off and visiting places.
Very much so. I hadn't thought about it like that, but yeah.
Now, obviously, this is one of those experiences which you can have and make the most of tourism within England itself. And are you getting people from overseas coming along and you know, enjoying the city that's got more canals than Venice and has also got probably more paddle sport groups than Venice too?
It wouldn't surprise me. Yeah, we do. We get guests from all over the place. I mean, over the last year, we had people from Canada, China, India, you know, all over the world. And it was, you know, I personally loved that about it because, you know, you get to hear stories about places that, you know, I've not been but would love to go and things like that. It's a real mix of people that we get. And then on the flip side of that, we get locals that live near the canal and have seen us paddle past and we're like, oh, I didn't know I could do that, and have then come and joined.
Yeah, and again, it's an interesting water sport, which is just a train road away from us here, and not going in a direction you'd have thought of going to take part in a water sport.
Very much so, yeah. We often get, when we're paddling along, reactions from people on the towpath. They're like, oh, I had no idea I could kayak on the canal. It's like, come join.
So, incredibly good fun. Obviously, something which is... literally, I mean, changed your life around with what's going on. And this is, again, another important part of tourism in England, isn't it? The fact that it employs so many people. And getting to showcase history and a chance to see behind the scenes, effectively, from the canal in a way which most people don't. Even if you've got a barge or an arrowboat, it's you still don't see as much as you would do at the pace at which you're going, which is your own pace.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I like calling it like a duck's eye view because we are that much lower and so, you know, we are quite close to the water and you don't really get the full scope of everything that's around you when you're walking along the towpath or even on a narrow boat. But the minute you're on the kayak, it's just, you are so small compared to everything around you. And it's, for me, it's one of my favorite things about it. It's just an amazing perspective.
Well, it sounds like a really awesome job to be doing, one that is quite clearly made for you, which is the other good part of it. And it's so good to see you enjoying your work. But as I say, it's all part of that bigger tourism picture. And people can find out about all the sort of events that are taking place and the access that they can get through the website for English Tourism Week.
So if they visit england.org.uk, there's information about everything that's happening with Tourism Week on there.
And how do we find out about your work at the Roundhouse in Brum?
So that is through the roundhousebirmingham.org.uk. We're also on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. No, X now, isn't it? Come behind the times.
And yeah, check out what's going on, how you can get involved, and most importantly, support tourism in England, whether it be going to Birmingham, which feels like a million miles away sometimes from Wolverhampton, or whether you're heading up the M6 and going to, I don't know, York or something like that. There are all sorts of great opportunities to, you know, visit some brilliant things in the UK. No need to head abroad. And as I say, if you fancy a change of scenery and some water sports, yet still being able to see what's going on and be nice and close to the infrastructure that we have, making it easy to get home afterwards, however soggy you end up. I think the fun of paddle sports at the Birmingham Roundhouse is going to be absolutely brilliant. Lily Rose Shepherd, thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me.
Taylor Simner is somebody who we caught up with back in December of 2019, finding out about his career in the world of youth modelling and also in acting too. He's continued to go from strength to strength in his work, visited all sorts of places all over the world and had all sorts of gigs. And he's here now to tell us all what's going on. Hello, sir. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good. Thanks. You?
So, I'm good. Thank you. How old are you these days then?
I'm 13.
So with a major career at the age of 13, this is quite an interesting one. I mean, you've recently been in New York, haven't you?
Yeah, I was doing New York Fashion Week.
And this, again, it must be an interesting challenge for you, not only to fit in with your studies, but also to generally, you know, get to grips with the sort of things that you're finding yourself doing anyway.
Yeah, it is quite a challenge, yeah.
So what else has been going on? Give us a bit of the rundown of what's been happening.
Obviously, I mentioned New York Fashion Week. I've done a show with my youth theatre company. I've done sex education in September. I was in the background for that. And BBC's Dodger.
So you've been appearing in quite a bit of telly, which is good to see. And obviously, this is something that you, you know, it's a lifelong dream, even at the age of 13, to be doing this sort of stuff. And it's quite impressive on how well the career is going so far.
Yeah, it is.
So what are the plans next? Because I know you enjoy these different areas of work. So what is the aim? What is the Taylor story going to be?
So I've got, like I mentioned, another show lined up with my youth theatre company. I'm pretty sure I've got some films that I've taped for, which I'm waiting to hear back on. Mm-hmm. And I think I've got a couple of modelling things coming up as well.
So it has been quite interesting, though, because obviously you've been doing a lot of this throughout the pandemic, which obviously changed the way the world saw everything from entertainment through the rest of life, too. So that must have been an interesting one, doing what you were doing then.
Yeah, it really was. Yeah, it was how I actually got contact with my agent through these Zoom classes.
It's the agent which makes all the difference, and having somebody working for you and getting you into gigs, but also being able to showcase your stuff. The stuff you do with Smile Youth Theatre, Poseidon is the role in their forthcoming production, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
So tell us a bit about how that's going at the moment.
It's going well, yeah. I've got the roles Poseidon and another little role as well, which because obviously I've swinged for the other little role. Poseidon's going really well, though. He's the dad of the main character, so it's a good role to play.
Now, that's all coming at the Dunstan Theatre in Sedgley on the 26th and 27th of July. Yeah. Are you a triple threat? I mean, is there singing and dancing involved as well? Is this something that you can do?
I'm doing singing and dancing classes, but I definitely say acting's my strength.
Yeah, that's where you can see it going. And with the being involved in TV programs, what's it like at your age? Because obviously you've got your youth advocate who'll be looking after you throughout all of this. But it's still interesting being part of these screen roles, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. So you usually get there, get into your trailer, find out the rundown on the scene and the costume you're going to wear. You usually put your costumes on and then get transported to the filming location.
And are there many run-throughs, or how does it work?
There's not actually many run-throughs, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of sitting around, to be honest.
There's a lot of waiting and a small amount of screen time, but all that equates into doing some good stuff on the telly. And how do your schoolmates cope with all this? Because, I mean, you're not big-headed, you're a grounded lad, but it's still quite interesting for them hanging around with the celebrity, surely.
They're all really proud of me. I don't really mention it too much in school because I don't want to feel like I'm bragging. But the ones that I have told, they're all really proud.
And have you been recognised? You know, someone's come in the following day. Hang on, I saw you in Casualty last night.
Nah, no one. I wish.
Oh, yeah. it will come. I'm sure those times will be there. But obviously, it's all about then about the brand and the concept. And yeah, I know you do like to share some of your antics on Instagram, don't you?
Yeah, Taylor Simner Official on Instagram.
And I mean, do you have the team working with you behind these shots as well? Because it's not just selfies, is it? This is you in the air when you're out and about doing your jobs.
Yeah, it's my mom that runs it all.
And hopefully you've got on a very low percentage. That's the important thing. You don't have to pay her too much, do you?
Surprisingly.
That works quite well. So, I mean, what are the aims still? Obviously, you're enjoying the world of acting. GCSEs are not too far away. Is drama going to feature there?
Yeah, definitely. I'm picking my options next month, so I know that I want to do something related to drama. So
and then potentially at university and or maybe one of the theatre schools to further that?
Yeah, because what I was thinking of doing is this one local to me where in year 10, you can leave and go to that school where it's mainly focused on drama, which I was thinking of doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, that's good to hear, and it'd be interesting to see how the career continues. Do keep us posted. But at the moment, I mean, the likes of New York Fashion Week, is your home for something maybe back down in London again in the not too distant future?
Yeah, I'd really hope something like that. Because obviously, I did London Fashion Week when I was 9 and New York when I was 13. So it just felt like it was just enjoyed because I've done both now, two of the capitals for modelling.
Yeah, but when Eye Candy Couture, though, I mean, you've been doing some modelling for them for their winter coat range whilst you're out in New York as well. So again, appearing in online catalogues there.
Yeah, it was outside, so I had loads of people stopping to take photos, and that's what I was doing. So that was also really good.
Yeah, working on the No Hate campaign out there in New York as well. Again, that's an honour to be part of that sort of thing as well.
Yeah, that was really interesting to do. I really enjoyed that one.
Taylor Simner Official is what you're looking for on Insta. Check out the details there. And any TV credits coming up in the not too distant future?
None on the top of my head right now.
But again, there could be repeats. So and Casualty will no doubt appear on some of the gold channels at some point in the not too distant future, which tends to come around quite regularly. So your next gig, as we've said, is Poseidon at the Dumston Theatre in Sedgley, all part of the work of Smile Musical Youth Theatre, and that's on the 26th and 27th of July. Give them a follow on Facebook or Insta, and you'll be able to check out all the details there. Keep up the good work. Break a leg, I think we have to say, for all of your productions and stuff. But it'd be great to hear more about the modelling and stuff in the not-too-distant future.
Yeah, it will be.
That's all for this week. Thank you so much for joining me. Back with episode 770 next week. Hope to see you then. Ta-ra for now.
Goodbye from the milk bar. Goodbye from the milk bar. Goodbye from the milk bar. Goodbye from the milk bar, yeah. Goodbye from the milk bar, yeah.